Welcome. You're watching The Buck Stops Here, and I'm Barkhadat. The big story tonight, terrorism deja vu. This time too, it is Europe that is under siege. After Paris, it is Brussels that has come under attack after a series of multiple attacks, two at the airport's departure lounge and one at a major metro station, leaving 34 people dead and over 200 injured, with the Brussels government warning that other terrorists may still be at large. Brussels city has gone into lockdown mode as a massive manhunt begins to try and capture and track down the perpetrators of these terror attacks. Over the next 60 minutes in this one-hour special, we'll be asking whether, in fact, we, the world, are losing the war on terror. Is the ISIS being able to inflict terror at will? And is the debate around terrorism still mired in both politics and political correctness? All this and much more coming up on a chilling day for the world at large, looking at these horrific images that you see on your screen. Metro coaches completely destroyed, people running out of the airport, children crying, people taken off a metro coach in semi-darkness, and then of course our very own Jet Airways hub at the Brussels airport, two of the Jet Airways staff injured, the fear writ large on their faces. On our special program today, let's go across live to Brussels, where my colleague Rahul Venkat is with us. Rahul's in Brussels. Rahul, what is the latest? Bring us up to speed. The toll seems to be mounting with every hour. What is the situation right now? We know the city is in lockdown, but what is the government saying?
So the latest, Barkha, from the ground is that there are reports that the metro will slowly but surely be opened in a few hours. You know, one must understand that in a couple of hours, schools and offices will be closed and people will need to make their way home. So local reports coming in of limited circulation being allowed slowly. Islamic State has apparently claimed responsibility for these attacks that have taken place in Brussels this morning. And in fact, with me, Barkha, I have a survivor from one of the blasts that took place in Brussels earlier this morning. I have with me Nick Reinhardt, who was in Malbec metro station, who was in the same carriage in which the blasts took place. Nick, if I can quickly ask you to describe for us what you saw and what you experienced this morning in the metro station.
I was in the third wagon, and the explosion did happen in the second wagon. And so there was a loud bang, and then there was a big fire gaze just coming at us. So the whole wagon from the left side, from the right side, was full of fire.
And what did you see around you?
People just dropped to the floor. I still stood up. I don't know why. But I think I was just, I don't know, maybe scared or trying to assess what was happening. I don't know, but I stood to the ground. Also, some other people, but most people dropped to the floor. And
how did you make your way to safety?
How did I make my way to safety? I started talking on the phone to a friend. I called him because it was my last speed dial. And that really made me aware of the situation. So I tried to kick in a window that was on the railroad side, not on the platform side. But at that moment, I looked around me and I saw all the other windows were broken. So that felt stupid. And then I
mean, eventually, how did you reach? What did you see around?
I got out by going to the farthest way from the second wagon, and I took the third exit from that metro wagon. And because of probably a person from the metro helped us out, because at first the doors were blocked. And so then we got out, and I got out to the backside of the Malbec metro station like everybody else. I mean, some other people. And I was one of the last ones in it. So, but our people in our wagon, I think they were all okay because we were in an old metro station. I think that saved us our lives, because the open metros, they are, if that would have been the case, we would have been all massacred, I think.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you. So, Barkha, as you see there, these very vivid first-hand accounts of the attacks this morning coming in, describing just the pain and the sheer panic that they saw around them. Barkha?
Rahul, stay with us. We've got to get another eyewitness. In fact, it's Manoj Ladwa. We know him very well here in India. He's somebody who actually managed the campaign of Prime Minister Modi in 2014, closely associated with the BJP. Manoj, you are in Brussels. We're glad you're safe. Tell us what you're seeing around you. Tell us what you saw. A horrible day for the world at large.
Yes, indeed, Barkha. It has been a horrible time here. The mood is one of, I think, seeing people that are shell-shocked. They don't know what hit them. People wandering around the streets, just looking lost. A lot of military, police rushing around. It's been a very, I've been to Brussels many, many times. It's a vibrant place that today was a very serene sort of atmosphere and very worrisome people here.
And Manoj, what is it that you're sensing among people? Because the perception, of course, is that this is a reprisal attack, because just a couple of days ago, one of the Paris attackers was in fact apprehended from Brussels. There is a, you know, Brussels is not just Brussels, it's also home to the European Union, it's home to NATO. The Prime Ministers of Belgium and France have said we're at war, but there's a perception that we're losing this war. In fact, the world is losing the war on terror. What is it that you're sensing among the people you're talking to there?
Well, I think people around me, the people I've spoken to, do recognize this as a major reprisal for the capture of one of the perpetrators of the Paris attacks. And to that extent, there is a huge concern here that these terrorists can attack where they want, when they want, almost at will. And the security agencies are obviously grappling with the situation, and it's too early to say. There are a lot of people in hospital, and a lot of confusion that's happening, but as people start to reflect, there is a sense of despondency amongst a lot of people here.
And Manoj, is there a sense, you travel a lot, all of us travel, in some ways terror has become the ultimate product of globalization. There's a sense that no matter where you are, none of us are safe anymore, and that aviation and airports have almost become the new front line of the war on terror, because even here at home, Jet Airways today, multiple flights had to be taken aside because there were bomb threats. Most of them turned out to be not accurate, but in today's age, you can't take any chances. We saw Jet Airways staff injured today in Belgium. You know, aviation and airports, perhaps the most vulnerable today.
Well, that's exactly what the terrorists want us to think. That's exactly what the terrorists want us to feel and fear. And that's everywhere in the world. People are starting to see this, and this is what their game is. And I still have a strong belief in the human spirit, and I've seen that. Again, despite the despondency in many places, also people putting their arms around one another, helping people along. And I think that you'll find that Brussels will definitely rise, and you'll see a European-wide condemnation, indeed an international condemnation. Prime Minister Modi was one of the first to make a statement as well. This is a global problem, but you're seeing that, as India has been saying for some time now, Burke, as you know, that there needs to be a global and a united response to terror.
And Manoj, before we let you go, the Prime Minister, of course, as scheduled, is going to be in Brussels at the end of this month. This is not just an attack on one city. It is an attack perhaps on the entire European Union, on all of Europe. There is also a sense today, and we are seeing this play out in the American presidential elections as well, that terrorism and the debate around it everywhere in the world is mired both in politics and in political correctness. As somebody who's had a narrow escape yourself today, your thoughts on that before I take it to the panel?
Well, Prime Minister Modi, is coming at a time, and I'm really pleased that he is coming as scheduled. And the entire theme of his visit, as you may have seen on various Twitter messages, is stronger together. And it's coming with that sort of message and that sense of solidarity. This is the time to stay together. This is the time to stick together. Otherwise, this minority is just going to trample all over wherever we are, and all our values that we collectively believe in are going to be attacked. We've got to stand up to this, and I'm confident, you know, that Brussels will rise again. But you know, the whole world has to stand together. And Prime Minister Modi is absolutely right in making sure that he does not change his plans when he comes to Brussels at this time.
Well, Manoj, we're glad you're safe. Manoj Ladva in Brussels there live on his own experience and his own thoughts. Thank you very much. Taking it straight now to the panel, are we losing the war to terror? Is the terrorist actually outsmarting us? Is the terrorist able to get attention at will by inflicting fear at will? And what about the politics, and some would say the political correctness, that prevent a global consensus and often even in India a national consensus on terrorism? How vulnerable is India, especially when we talk about the ISIS? ISIS supporters are already issuing chilling statements. One of them on social media sites talking about how we have come to slaughter. Let's introduce our guests now. Joining us on the program tonight is G. Parthasarathy, former Indian High Commissioner of Pakistan. Also joining us is General Ata Hasnain, former General Officer Commanding of the 15th Corps in the Kashmir Valley. Jason Burke, he is of course a well-known journalist, but also the author of The New Threat from Islamic Militancy. Shahid Siddiqui, editor of Nayi Dunya. Seshadri Chari, BJP member, but also a strategic affairs expert, is with us. And finally, Patrick French, columnist and author, is with us. Ambassador Parthasarathy, your first thoughts. How has Europe ended up becoming the epicenter of these terror attacks?
Well, I think the European Union members of NATO were ill-advised to get into military adventures like they did, into Iraq, then Syria, and Libya. And what has happened is the ISIS has emerged from members of Saddam Hussein's Republican Guard in the Anbar province because they are Sunnis dispossessed. The same thing has happened in Syria. You try to throw out a secular government, and then you join the Saudis and the Turks with this fundamentalist groups. Your leadership gets involved in some of these neighboring countries in petroleum purchases. These are the wages of sin. So I think, let us be very clear, while yes, we must condemn these acts of terrorism, yes, we all have to get together to deal with it, but let us be very clear about the origins of this particular phase of terrorism. I mean, more or less you're unraveling the Sykes-Picot Pact, which determined the frontiers in these areas, and it is going to continue. I think we'll say, later discuss the implications for India, but this is really a phenomenon of West Asia and North Africa, in which fighters of disgruntled Muslims from the European Union, I'm told there are about 1,700 from France, also from Russia, another 2,500 from Russia, Saudi Arabia, Turkey. And this is the composition of ISIS. Their estimates vary from something between 30,000 and 100,000. The Russian general staff, very well informed, says they are 70,000. So it's going to be a tough battle. It's a battle that must be fought, because this form of barbarity that the ISIL propagates has to be challenged and defeated.
Patrick, if I can bring you in as somebody who has spent, I believe, many of your summers in Brussels. It's a city you know well, it's a city you've loved, but this is not city-specific anymore. This is, you know, although there's an interesting statistic that as a percentage of population, Belgium actually sends the highest number of Muslim men who fight with the ISIS in Syria, as a percentage of population, not in absolute numbers. What happened to Europe? I mean, you know, we thought our part of the world had to worry, that we were the diverse sort of melting pots where the diversity was unmanageable. How did this happen to Paris and Brussels?
Well, the first thing is to say how sad that a wonderful city like Brussels that I visited down the years has had to endure these attacks today. But the way to answer your question is perhaps to say that this is now a universal phenomenon. No country is exempt from what is happening. And you're right. I mean, statistically, Belgium has put far more people into groups like Islamic State than any other European country. And there are a series of reasons for that. It's to do with the fact that integration of different minorities within Belgium has never been very effective or successful. It's the fact that for many years Belgium has had weak governments and does not have particularly effective security and intelligence agencies. And even if you go back, I don't know if you remember a couple of days before 9/11, when the Afghan leader Ahmed Shah Massoud was assassinated, that plot started out in Brussels. So this is a deep problem that has been brewing for many years and will take many years to defeat.
And Patrick, the global debate, before I bring in Seshadri Chaudhry on this, you know, you've already seen the Donald Trump and the Ted Cruz jumping into this debate with some perfectly obnoxious statements. But the fact of the matter is that jihadist terror is going to embolden the politicians on the right wing of the spectrum, and the Trumps and the Cruzes, Ted Cruz, in fact, saying we don't need yet another boring lecture on Islamophobia. Do you believe that there's a certain amount of denialism that continues to plague the debate around terrorism today?
Well, I don't think there's denialism, but I think there is perhaps a failure to understand the theoretical arguments that groups like Al-Qaeda or Islamic State use to justify their actions. They have an express political purpose. They wish to destabilize. They wish to terrorize, and to that extent they do succeed when events like this get the kind of publicity that they do. And they will always have the asymmetric advantage. No state, however well organized its security and intelligence agencies are, can ever stop people going into a public place and detonating a bomb or pulling out a gun. That is the nature of the modern world. I was in touch earlier today with a friend of mine, Mark Scarvers, who's a Belgian journalist, a very well-known cultural journalist, and he was talking about his two daughters being in lockdown in different parts of Brussels, and he said, this is the modern world. That is the harsh reality. It's not something that is going to change. It is the nature of modernity that you have asymmetric warfare run by terrorist organizations which are very hard to defeat.
And asymmetric war, of course, throws up different kinds of questions. Seshadri Chaudhry, they throw up ideological questions, they throw up political questions, they push some people further to the right of the spectrum. It's made its impact felt in the presidential campaign, as I was mentioning already, with Donald Trump talking about waterboarding terror suspects. Mr. Chaudhry, where is the world going wrong? Where are we going wrong? What does India need to learn from this?
I think we have to learn a lot of things about all these things. As was being mentioned, the most important element in this is the element of surprise, as is there in any kind of terrorist attack. So whoever planned it, whoever masterminded it, has done three things. Number one, the idea of retribution. You arrested our people in Paris, we will strike back. And they have been able to strike back. The second and the most important element is the element of surprise. And the third is the kind of suicide bombing that has been taking place in this part of the world. Suicide bombings were not very much known in this part of the world, but now unfortunately this is gaining ground, and this is the greater danger as far as the freedom loving Western world is concerned. And we have to learn many more lessons from this aspect, because close on the borders of India, we have countries which use terrorism as some sort of a state policy, and which has nurtured non-state actors and has completely been denying the existence of such units. Whether we are able to expose them or not is another issue, but there have been lapses and there have been intelligence inputs, and we have not been able to carry out those intelligence inputs and guard ourselves against it. If a state like Brussels, or if a state like the US, or probably there have been metro bombings, there have been tube bombings in London, and there have been such incidents in even a country like China, there have been incidents all over the West.
But you
know, we are not untouched of these things. I think.
But I was going to make the point that whether in Brussels or Washington or New Delhi, one of the problems is that there is no political consensus, not just on the battle tactics required to fight terrorists, but on how you see terror, what you see is the origins, what are the words you use. And you know, the Prime Minister at the World Sufi Conference a few days ago said there is no link between religion and terrorism. But one of the presidential candidates in the United States of America, Ted Cruz, let me just read out to you what he said. He said, radical Islam is at war with us. For over 7 years, we've had a president who refuses to acknowledge this reality. And the truth is, we can never hope to defeat this evil so long as we refuse to name it. We will name our enemy. It's radical Islamic terrorism. So you have this school of thought, and then you have the other school of thought saying, any terrorist who uses religion is in fact defiling religion, so there is no connection. Where do you weigh?
Yes, he has said it, and he seems to be gaining a little bit of support from a small but significant group of population in that country for whatever he has said. But I don't agree with that view, and a majority of the people in the United States also. In fact, I was there just last week. I returned yesterday, and I've been able to speak to a number of people who are connected with politics and who are also connected with business. Fortunately, a number of people don't agree with what he says, and they don't agree with the kind of solutions that he is trying to wriggle out of the situation.
But I still feel
that it is an ideological war, no doubt, but it is not a religious war. Therefore, what Prime Minister Modi said is very significant. And the program that was being organized, which was being planned in Brussels on the 30th of March, significantly yes. says the same thing. We should remain together and work together as a support base to one another on this particular issue of terrorism. And any political dissent can be discussed with, and any political dissent cannot be solved through violence. Therefore, in this particular issue, whatever may have been the reasons for this act, whatever may be the reasons of terrorism, I tend to agree with Partho on number of issues, but unfortunately on this issue, I don't think this is the time for us to look into the reasons for this, but rather come to discuss about the solutions and find common solutions.
But can you find the solution without the reasons? I'll put that to Ambassador Parthasarathy in just a moment. Jason Burke, you have spent a long time chronicling Islamic militancy. You've interviewed people who came back from the brink. You wrote a very moving article about a young woman who almost found herself at the edge and then she stepped back. Europe has actually created de-radicalization centers. We in the subcontinent actually believe that this is a relative to the rest of the world, a minor problem with us. We don't have those many young men radicalized, ready to go to Syria. Where is the gap in this discourse? Because every time this happens, there's a sense of deja vu. We've seen this happen before. We have shows like this. Another attack happens.
Well, it's an ongoing threat that evolves. I mean, we're in the middle of the fourth wave of Islamic militancy to be seen in the Middle East or come out of the Middle East and affect countries, this country, other countries, the US, Europe, over the last 40 years. And each one has grown in intensity, peaked after 4 or 5 years. At that point, counter-terrorist organizations begin to develop the capabilities to roll back that threat. There are a variety of political reactions to that threat. Key individuals among the terrorists tend to be killed or incarcerated, and that threat tends to diminish. We saw that in the last decade. You'll see that we had a major period of intense violence in between 2001 and 2005. We then had a calmer period from 2005 to 2010 or 11 when bin Laden was then killed, and now we're back on another upswing of another cycle. So these attacks repeat themselves seems to me to be fairly inevitable. This is a problem which has very deep roots in the Islamic world, in the Islamic world's relationship with the West, cultural factors, political factors, economic factors, historical factors that are working themselves out, sometimes in a violent way, and will continue to do so for decades to come. And that is where we are. That is the new reality. It is not the case that we've never been through this before. We've been through previous waves of terrorism, particularly in the West, which were not religious. So if you look at the terrorism of the 1960s or the 1970s, particularly even into the 1980s, most of it was actually nationalist or ethnic or separatist or secular in one way or another, anti-colonial or very hard left-wing or very hard right-wing. None of it had anything to do with religion. So there are two different things here. Terrorism is a continuing problem for all, particularly democratic societies. The religious terrorism, particularly the Islamic militancy, is something that has developed over the last 40 years and is evolving steadily, largely because the factors for its existence continue to be important.
Yeah, let me take that to General Hussain and Shahid Siddiqui quickly, and then we'll take it around the panel again. General Hussain, where do we see religion and terrorism in this debate? Because we all believe that this is the defilement of faith. But the fact is, you would remember what President Obama said after Paris, and he said sometimes from the Muslim community there is not the pushback that is needed. Now, Obama is hardly a conservative politician, so he would be considered far too left by his opponents. How do you see this?
Firstly, Barkha, firstly let me start by saying I deeply regret the loss of lives in Brussels and condemn this attack completely. Taking it from there, this issue has been building up for far too long. You know, I mean, if you really go into the history of it, it's right through the entire, almost the entire 20th century that this issue has built up. And it's come to a head sometime in the later part of the 20th century, and now we are seeing it moving forward. There are no shortcuts and no solutions to this immediately, and everyone understands that this is a long drawn out war, which requires a tremendous amount of stamina. And if you have to find solutions, ultimately they have to be comprehensive. Political, social, economic, military. Unfortunately, so far, as Ambassador Parthasarathy very correctly said, our solutions seem to have been very military in nature. The world does not seem to have understood the ideological battles which are involved in this entire thing. Not too many people around the world intellectually understand Islam and understand what is troubling Islam. I think that is the root cause behind it. We don't have a consensus even in the international community, among the security community, as to what is the definition of terrorism, what is the definition of militancy. So we find responses which are half-baked and ultimately keep on adding problems every other day. But coming back to your specific question itself, obviously, Samuel P. Huntington, if you go back to the Clash of Civilizations, you can justify it, you can fight against it, but ultimately this is an ideological war. And there are elements within the faiths who are fundamentalist, radical, whatever you wish to call. There are elements, you have a thing called fundamentalism, to which I have no objections. You want to fundamentally follow your religion or your faith, please follow it as long as you don't impose it on anyone else. The moment you start imposing it on anyone else, we have serious objections. And that has to be fought. And this is the manner in which this entire thing has to pan out in the future. I once again reiterate, this is not a single, it's not an issue of single concept to be fought. It has to be a comprehensive war fought out in all the domains. And the world has to have the stamina and the patience to be able to see it through. You keep doing it tactically from time to time, you're not going to find solutions to this.
Let me just bring in Shahid Siddiqui. Shahid Siddiqui, do you accept what at least a few people have said today, that this is it, in part at least, or in large part, an ideological war? In which case, if ideological battles continue to divide those who are fighting the terrorists, what hope do we have of winning?
Barkha, just after 9/11, I had said that this is a battle for the hearts and minds of the Muslims, and it cannot be won by armies and missiles and air bombing. And that has been the case. Number one, the radical Muslims have always been there for 1400 years. But these radical Muslims were always very weak. They didn't have the ground to dominate. But what happened in Afghanistan after the Soviet Union's intervention, what happened in Iraq and in Libya and now Syria after the American intervention, has allowed this radical, so-called radical Muslims to become stronger and get the support of those who were not with them.
Shahid, there are those who would say that's a rationalization. There are those who would say, and so, they do say that, that when
Barkha,
you start looking
Barkha,
for these
reasons, is,
when you start attributing Barkha, it to
Barkha,
Barkha, a rationalization.
Barkha, do you want me to say that Islam is the root cause? It is not. If it was, then it wouldn't have been there for last...
Those are not my politics. You know the part of the public debate. The part of the public debate last time after Paris, when you said this, when Manish Shankar Raya said this, you were accused, you were called apologist.
Barkai, you don't allow me to speak. The point is that people have their views, but my view is that this radical Islam has always been there. It has been very, very strong. But it has always been defeated by larger sections of Muslims, and even today it's not an Islamic issue. It's basically a middle issue of the Middle East. So people confuse it with the issue of Islam. It is not. It's a problem of the Middle East. And secondly, what is the what do they want to convey? These terrorists, whom I call scum of the society, they want to paralyze the civilized world, and civilized world has to fight them back very strongly, not by uncivilizing ourselves, not by going the Trump way, but going the Obama way. And I agree with President Obama that Muslim response should be much stronger. Muslims, it is the duty of Muslims now, because they are on the receiving end from both sides, from IS, Al-Qaeda, as well as from all those who regard Muslims as the root cause and Islam as the root cause of terrorism. Therefore, Muslims have to fight it both ways. And it is their duty to come out and fight the terrorists and to also make things, you know, in balance, bring out the balanced view of Islam. So this fight has to be fought mainly by Muslims, and they have to be very, very vocal about it. There's no question of my, you know,
I don't have to carry
my secularism on my sleeve or to justify or rationalize. No, has to be explained, and the explanation is necessary in order to fight it back. If you don't accept the explanation, you will be helping the IS, you will be helping the Al-Qaeda, you will be helping the Taliban if you go the Trump way.
Let me bring in Ambassador Parthasarathy. Ambassador Parthasarathy, if it's not as simple as saying military interventions that were wrong create hotbed of terrorists, because Vietnam by the Americans was perhaps their most flawed war. It did not lead to a generation of terrorists. It led to a generation of protesters. So the fact is that it is perhaps too simplistic to locate this within flawed American or hypocritical Western policy.
Well, let me put it that Vietnam was a disaster. This one is heading for another disaster. But let me go a bit deeper into this. This has also got a civilizational content of Iranian-Arab rivalry. Fundamentally, the Saudis were promoting these groups to take on Iran.
Yes.
Then the Americans, because the Saudis are doing it, joined these groups to destabilize Syria. So right now, I think there are some positive developments. I think Saudi Arabia is pulling back. It's behaving very responsibly. The Iranians remain the solid opposition to the whole ISIS affair. They are fighting. They are losing lives. There is a Shia-Sunni sectarian element in this. So to call this Islamic in very generic terms, I'm afraid, is not correct. Because the largest opposition to and shedding of lives is coming from the Shias in Iraq. It's coming from the Iranians. Yeah. It's coming from Hezbollah. And it's coming in Syria from the Assad regime. So it is a complex situation. Yes, Wahhabi Islam, as earlier promoted, has been the ideological background for the ISIS. They say so. But remember one thing, Barkha. From across the subcontinent, from Pakistan, 70 people have joined this movement. 23 from India have joined this movement. So I think there is also a fact of an Arab, if I may say, racist attempt, which subcontinentals are averse to, whether they are Pakistani or Indian. So it is a very complex problem. But coming back to this incident, now that it has arisen, like Shahid says, we have to oppose this form of violence in the name of Islam. Absolutely, there is no question of that. We have to join the West. We have to join the others. We have to cooperate with the Iranians. But remember one thing. All this talk about ISIS coming into India and the subcontinent is a red herring. Right now, the Taliban has sent a delegation for discussions with Iran on how to fight the ISIS. So our dangers and the threat, terrorist threat we face is more immediate. And I don't see very great Western criticism of the sort of terrorist threat that we face. There are all sorts of rationalizations.
That's a good point.
But there is not. Let's face it, for 26/11, Headley's confessions were shared with Denmark. It took them 1.5 years later to share it with us. Let's be real about what I'm saying is, I'm happy that now everybody is talking in India of building a pluralistic society in which whatever your religion, we all come together. India will succeed in dealing with this when we build our society according to our constitution. Everything else we can fight.
I think that's very well said. But Patrick, as I bring you in, I just want to bring up a picture that the Belgian police has in fact released moments ago. We brought you a glimpse of it, but let's bring it up again. This is a picture released of the men who are in fact suspected of being responsible for the bomb explosions at the airport. There are three men pushing trolleys, all three put on the suspect list. These images released by the Belgian police, if anybody had seen them, please do respond to them. The helpline numbers and the numbers where you can write in are on the screen below. Patrick, this is an interesting point that Ambassador Parthasarathy makes about A, not being about Islam because of the Shia-Sunni dimension, B, the difference between the subcontinent's engagement with this kind of fundamentalism and the Arab world's engagement with it. In fact, much of the Western world, many of these people are Westerners who are, you know, neo-Islamists.
Well, I mean, Islamist extremism has mutated in an extraordinary way over the last 80 or 90 years. It theoretically, at least, originated in India with Abu Ala Mardudi in the 1920s and 30s. It then got translated into Arabic and was taken up by people like Sayyid Qutb in Egypt in the 50s, and it really got going in the 1990s and then after 9/11. So we've seen this extraordinarily rapid theoretical evolution of an idea where you've had the merger, if you like, of a South,
I think Shai is trying to make an interjection there.
About Wahhabis. No, I was going to come on to that and say that what you're looking at really...
Wahhabis are much earlier, before Maududi. And
exactly,
Maududi was influenced by Wahhabism.
Well, I think it was more the other way around, that there was then a merger between Maududi's thinking and the kind of ideas that had come up in the 18th century and then led to the creation of what's now the modern Saudi state. But the point I really wanted to make is that you have this extraordinary tragic irony where a little country like Belgium, with a population of, what, 12 or 13 million people, sends far more radicalized fighters to join this war in West Asia than a giant country like India. So, you know, this is one of those cases where India must be doing something right. There are very few international Islamist terrorists going from India to other parts of the world, whereas if you look at countries like my own country, the UK or Belgium or France, you see this radicalization of people who are second or third generation from those countries.
Let me bring in Jason. How do you explain that, Jason? You spent a long time in India, but you've also seen these trends outside. And, you know, looking at this from India, we find it befuddling. We find it befuddling because we thought these problems would be ours. They seem to have become much more Europe's problems, the Western world's problems, in particular Europe.
Well, I think you have to be serious about and sensible about quite what levels of radicalization, what involvement in extremist ideologies there are in Europe. I mean, as Patrick says, Belgium is a country of around 11 million, 12 million people, has around 500,000 Muslims living there. We're talking about maybe 500 plus, around 500 to 600 who've actually traveled to Syria in the last 5 years, which is not a huge number proportionately. It's also the case that Belgium might well not actually be the highest proportionate country because other countries may well be underestimating the numbers that are going to Syria. Certainly France or Germany may well be. But leaving that aside, I mean, it's certainly the case that Europe has a variety of problems in integrating Muslim communities. This is particularly the case in France, as we've learned recently. Belgium has a very similar profile. You have basically the creation of a situation where there are large numbers of young men who are feeling frustrated, who are feeling alienated, who are susceptible to ideologies, whether they be political Islamist, Qutubist, Wahhabi, modern Bin Ladenist version, an ISIS version, whatever. They have an attraction, and they have an attraction often that is neither ideological nor religious, but is simply the opportunity to go and do something which is much more interesting and much more empowering in their view than staying at home and doing some half-bit job which nobody's very interested in. And it's also worth pointing out that a lot of these people get involved in Islamic militancy not because they want to be suicide bombers or they want to kill people in their own countries. Often they go to Syria to fight what they see as the good cause. I mean, it isn't obviously, but that's how they see it. And over there they become much more brutalized, much more radicalized, and then they come back to attack. And that's an important distinction. It is the conjunction of these circumstances, this context in Western Europe and the Syrian-Iraqi civil wars, if you like, those two coming together that has caused this particular problem. And it's, as I say, it's a conjunctural one. There's a whole series of circumstances that have come together, and those circumstances will eventually be unpicked and will move into a different phase, possibly a better one, possibly a worse one.
General Hussain, you wanted to come in there.
I wanted to come in on this issue particularly. If I may, Barkha, just quote a few statistics. Belgium is a country of about 11.5 million people. And it's got a 25% migrant population of all faiths. My research tells me Brussels itself has got approximately 26% Muslim population. Now, this is all a question of integration. Why I want to compare with India. You have that many million Muslims in Brussels who are in different stages of integration at the moment. The first generation of people who came basically from the Francophonic countries like Morocco, etc., came in and got integrated with low-level jobs. But the problem is the second and third generations are not willing to take those low-end jobs. And that is causing the major problem. Unlike in India, where you see 175 million strong population of Muslims. Obviously, something is right out here. The integration, the process of integration over the last 75 years, although we cast a lot of aspersions on it, there is something right here. And that needs to be kept in mind. And the Western world needs to have a look at the Indian model here as to how India, with this giant of a Muslim population, has been able to integrate it.
I want to actually take that to Seshadri Chari because, you know, everybody on this panel has actually said that maybe India is doing something right. But something, Mr. Chari, that Ambassador Parthasarathy said stays with me, that we will be secure if we just implement our constitution. And what worries me is recently we seem to have gone back to a kind of identity-oriented politics. We are discussing and fighting over nationalism. We are fighting over beef. We are fighting over things that peel into irrelevance in the light of this global terror threat and actually make us more vulnerable to terrorism and radicalization if they continue. Are you concerned as somebody who's been in politics about this kind of politics?
Oh, I don't think we are, I mean, to use your own terminology, fighting over. I don't see any major terror attack or a war on these issues. This could be disagreement. There is a segment which tries to disagree with this kind of
issue. No, I'm just saying, does it sow the seeds of a certain kind of social alienation?
No,
social alienation, not terrorism.
No,
which then becomes a breeding ground for...
There is no social alienation also. And I don't think we are ready to look at this as a social alienation. But what is happening in the West now and what is happening in the Indian situation is very different. And this is what we have been telling the West also for a very long time. These are all certain issues of cultural integration. These are issues of social integration, which we have tackled very well. India is not a place where religion says you do this and you do not do this. India has been able to integrate with all religious feelings and sentiments. But when we were saying the same thing, when we are talking about a radicalization of a religion, remember, even without any kind of religious element or radicalization, there has been a major terror impact on Sri Lanka. And we have always been saying that we should treat the Sri Lankan situation, the LTTE, as a terror organization. The West has not agreed to that. And the military intervention in Sri Lanka was the biggest stumbling block of the development of Sri Lanka as far as the West is concerned. At the same time, the kind of terrorism that is being perpetrated against us from across the border, the West is West is calibrating and very seriously ignoring this issue. They have been ignoring it. In spite of our warnings, in spite of our concerns, US has been supplying F-16 to Pakistan, and they are actually building a kind of terror network which is very dangerous, which is very bad. So this is the idea that the West has to realize, and I feel that certain differences of opinion that may exist in a society like India do not constitute a war against a religion or kind of an intolerance towards a religion. There are a number of Muslims who have acted on this issue. There are a number of Hindus who have acted on this issue. Our constitution is very clear. Our implementation of the constitution is also very clear on these issues. Therefore, I don't see a kind of quote-unquote a war emanating in our society, in our constitutional thing. And we are a democracy. And what happens, what needs to be done in the West also, is along with this integration, along with de-radicalization, we have also to instill the idea of democracy in these countries and democracy among these people. And we have to build democratic institutions, and that democratic institution building process has been going on in India for a long time. This democratic institution building process has not been taking place in some of the Western world, and that is the reason why this comes up.
Shai Siddiqui, a quick last word before we close. Shai.
Yeah, I agree with Chari, and you know, in Indian, among Indian Muslims, we have stood up to terrorism for last 30 years, which was being exported by our neighbor to India. Indian Muslims have totally rejected it. That is because of our ethos, our history and traditions which we have built in last 1,000 years. But now a section of Muslims, especially the younger section of Muslims, is getting influenced by what is happening either in Europe or America or elsewhere through internet, through social media. And this group, I find, is alienated even from the, you know, the ethos we have built in so many centuries. And we have to take care of these younger people and not believe that nothing will happen. Things can happen. You need a few dozen people to really create this kind of situation you have in Brussels today. And therefore, we have to be very cautious, and therefore, we should not allow the kind of some debates which do take place, which are taking place in the country in last few years. I'm not holding anybody responsible for it, but they are influencing the minds of the younger people, and that's where we have to be extremely cautious. Otherwise, we may have some problems on our hand, which may take some time to really come to terms with.
Can I make one more point?
Yeah, go ahead, Jason.
It's Patrick.
Oh, is that Jason or Patrick?
Yeah.
Sorry, Patrick.
I just wanted to say that the capture of Salah Abdeslam, the supposed Bataclan bomber who was arrested 4 or 5 days ago in Brussels, it is extraordinary to think that he was on the run in the middle of the Belgian capital for a period of 4 months. In an equivalent situation in India, that would be almost unimaginable. So I think that in that sense, the Indian experience can be useful, the idea of how communities deal with extreme renegades from within. And I think that the one person or group of people we should not listen to are American presidential candidates like Donald Trump, like Ted Cruz, who have no knowledge of Muslim communities, they have no knowledge of Islamist thought, they have no knowledge of what it means to try to integrate populations who've recently moved from one place to another a generation or two ago. So let's not take advice from that particular source. Let's, on this point at least, take it from the Indian context.
Can I have 30 seconds?
Yeah, go ahead.
As a last word, my advice to the Western world, to Europe, would be there will be temptations at this time to use the, you know, the kinetic route to resolve these problems. You should use it, there's no doubt. Military methods have to go in. Counterterrorism measures have to be taken. Defensive and offensive measures have to be taken. But I think the strength of your response should be on the social response. That is where it should be. The integrative process of making sure that this generation of people in Europe, understand them, understand their ideology, and try and integrate them.
Barkha, one last point from me. Osama bin Laden, okay, and the Al-Qaeda won support worldwide. They couldn't find a single member in India. The same thing is going to happen to ISIS. We have more serious problems with Lashkar and Jaish. We'll take care of that also while maintaining our society and civilization intact.
Can I just ask all of you to just hold on for a half a moment before we wrap? I've got Captain Nikhil Aved. He's a Senior Vice President, Flight Operations with Jet Airways. I just want to bring up also the images we saw of Jet Airways staff injured today. A number of Indians take Jet Airways through Brussels, which is a major hub for the airline. Four of its aircraft were on the ground in Brussels today. Captain Nikhil, what can you tell us? What's the latest? We hope your staff members are recovering and well.
Yes, Barkha, all our passengers and our staff are all okay. I think there were some reports about two of our staff being injured. They are at the hospital currently. Our staff is with them and they are being given due medical attention.
And what about your aircraft, your passengers? The airport, of course, is shut. There's not much you can do at the moment.
So we are right now on the other line talking to the airport authorities in Brussels. But as of the last report that we have received, all our aircrafts are safe. They have been secured currently. The passengers have been taken to safe locations outside the airport. There are some passengers inside the airport as well.
And may I just ask you to talk a little bit about how you keep your staff calm, your pilots calm, people who have to fly through airports which are becoming increasingly vulnerable to terror attacks? A lot of them have gone through utter trauma today.
Yes, Barkha. So, when we receive the first call, what we activate is an emergency response center, which is currently located at Mumbai. We have also set up an emergency response center in Brussels, which is supporting us with all the ground information. We are communicating with our staff internally as well as externally. Most of our staff who are in Brussels have been spoken to by all of senior management here. As far as our pilots are concerned, we know most of our crew is in hotels right now. We have been in touch with them, except for these two crew that I mentioned earlier. So, continuous updates are going out from our side as to what the situation is at the airport.
Yeah.
We are actually pleased that, all our staff and guests and crew all are fine.
And very quickly, a number of hoax calls today about bomb threats. Has that added to just the trauma of what you're dealing with?
We had to actually formulate a little bit of a different strategy in our emergency response as far as the bomb threats were concerned. We had all our aircrafts actually specifically checked out as per the procedure along with the authorities. And they were all sanitized before they departed again.
Well, this is the age of terrorism that we live in. Though, Ambassador Parthasarathy, your last words we leave our viewers with today, at least sitting here in India, horrified as we are of these images. Ambassador Parthasarathy believes that we are more at risk from the Jaish and the Lashkar and the terror that emanates right from across the border. But we leave it there. Nikhil Ved, thank you for talking to us. Thanks to our panel tonight. Taking a quick break on the other side, Mehbooba Mufti, finally, looks ready and set to be the next Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir.